Good news, everyone! There's finally something happening in America worth talking about. Bad news, though? What that something is. That's right, the Supreme Court gave the go-ahead for Trump's asylum restriction policy. It is something you'd probably just think happened if you only read the headlines. In fact, because, oh man, nothing in law is simple, well, this ruling actually had little to do with asylum policy and a lot more to do with temporarily standardizing border patrol regulations between states and announcing a policy without a discussion period. But who would click on that article? The case that actually determines whether this asylum policy is legal or not is scheduled to happen after the Supreme Court reconvenes November 4th. So if that's the case, then what did we just decide? And more importantly, what am I even talking about? Well, to understand all that, we need to take a few steps back. Without context, this update makes absolutely no sense. Now for this next part, I'm going to be leaning pretty heavily on one of my favorite sources for Supreme Court news, SCOTUS blog, who actually have a high rate of factual reporting and a least biased rating. I mean, it's hard to get better than that. So back to this case, what did the Supreme Court actually decide in this decision? Well, to understand that, we need to go back to July.
It applies to those coming across our southern border who have not applied for asylum in a country they have passed through on the way to the United States. So not Mexico, for instance, because they're next door, but for those beyond Mexico, they would be required to apply and then be denied and be able to prove they were denied asylum in a prior country.
Okay, let me translate that into English for you guys. If you're Mexican, you can apply for asylum in the United States. But if you're from a country where you have to cross through Mexico, you're gonna have to prove that you applied and were rejected from asylum in Mexico first. This is apparently to ensure that the only people filing for asylum in the United States are those who were rejected by Mexico. Sounds like not a great idea when your stated goal of this policy is to lessen the burden of false asylum claims on the system. But that's another argument for another day. This policy was announced on July 15th, and by July 24th, it was blocked nationwide by a temporary injunction from Trump's arch nemesis, the Northern District Court of California. This 30-page injunction, written by Judge John Tyler, laid out the policy against this policy. Oh, okay, everyone said. Well, I guess this is not happening in the United States. But the Attorney General, William Barr, had a different idea. He appealed this decision to the Ninth Circuit District Court, and that ruling made everything so much more confusing. It prohibited the government from enforcing the new rule in the geographic area covered by the Ninth Circuit, which would include the US-Mexico border in California and Arizona, but allowed the government to enforce the rule elsewhere in the United States, including along the border that Mexico shares with Texas. So, okay, that definitely took the wind out of the argument that this breaks federal law. This new court case based their partial injunction off of a very specific violation that we'll get to in a second, and said every other argument laid out in the first district court opinion was not applicable. The new status for this policy was feel free to apply for asylum anywhere on the West Coast. You're pretty chill over there. But anywhere else in the country, well, you better have been deemed ineligible somewhere else before you come to them. Now this is where the Supreme Court comes in, because the government wanted to know if they can enforce this rule nationwide while we figure out whether they can legally enforce this rule nationwide.
The court ruled in favor of the Trump administration by allowing the U.S. to deny and deport most Central Americans seeking asylum in the U.S. This ruling is only temporary while the legal fight plays out in the lower courts.
So yes, the Supreme Court just ruled that the Trump administration can, nationwide, enforce these rules until we figure out whether they can, legally, nationwide, enforce these rules. Now that we know where the battle lines were drawn and what the stakes are, let's get to the question I love answering. Why? Now generally I'd read from the court's opinion, but the justices are really trying to squeeze the most relaxation out of their summer recesses. and the only justice to actually publish an opinion was an angry Sotomayor writing why this decision was wrong. Come on, Roberts, you're not even going to write a paragraph sent via iPhone defending this? Now what are you going to do? Because of that, let's start with the winning federal government's argument, written by Trump's Solicitor General Noel J. Francisco. Now I know I'm beating a dead horse to the point where I'm now wailing on a bottle of Elmer's glue, but let me reiterate the government's goal one more time from their appeal. The injunction now in effect is deeply flawed and should be stayed pending appeal and pending any further proceedings in this court. His goal was not to defend the legality of Trump's asylum restrictions here, but rather to attack the illegality of barring its asylum policy through its legal challenges climbed through the courts. So for those of you still with me, this brings us to the question of the episode. Why can a district court not file an injunction over this very specific policy? Well, it comes down to something a lot more mundane than most of you would probably expect. The Ninth Circuit, the second appeal court that ruled that the West Coast will be accepting asylum claims from anywhere, while everywhere else in the country could reject you if you hadn't previously been rejected, denied a full stay solely on the ground that the departments likely should not have issued the rule as an interim final rule without advance notice and comment. Yeah, the big objection to this policy for the purposes of this injunction was the policy's rollout.
In previous administrations, they would make sure that all the agencies were on the same page, that they pumped out the same talking points, the same message. That's not the case here at the Trump administration.
This administration just kind of said, hashtag YOLO, brr, 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 brr. Here's our new asylum policy, figure it out. And it was really entertaining to watch reporters try to figure it out.
I want to start with actually what this regulation does, because I've heard about four different descriptions now. To whom does it apply and to whom does it not apply?
Legally speaking, this was a problem. Because according to the lower courts, for a government to introduce this kind of measure, departments needed to have advanced notice and a comment period. In order to win this argument, Solicitor General Francisco had a simple task. He had to convince the Supreme Court that, in this case, the president didn't need to give advance notice or a comment period. Now, to achieve this goal, Francisco opened up what might be the most boring act in United States history, the Administrative Procedure Act. Hoo-wee, not a single word of that inspired one iota of curiosity out of me. In reading through it, though, one phrase caught his eye. Say, he said, slamming down his massive law book, realizing he had cracked the case wide open. The Administrative Procedure Act, however, allows an agency to issue a rule without notice and comment procedures if the rule involves a foreign affairs function of the United States. Now, if he could successfully make the case that this policy, that had previously been defended as a relief to our asylum system, is actually related to foreign affairs, checkmate. So how do you do that? Well, there were a few arguments that he made, and some of them were a bit of a stretch. First, by channeling asylum claims to countries that the aliens first enter, the rule encourages foreign countries to partner with the United States and to shoulder their share of the burdens of mass migration. I love how even he put the word partner in quotes. The logic here is essentially, hey Mexico, you're a team player, right? Well, we're just gonna back these busloads of asylum seekers into your backyard. Okay, have fun. So glad we could encourage this partnership with the United States. Unfortunately, that still wasn't a sufficient argument on its own, because it still sounds a lot more like a domestic policy that impacts foreign affairs than a policy that was designed for the purposes of fostering cooperation on the issue. It might have achieved some of its goals, though, in the least diplomatic way possible.
And Mexico's foreign secretary also deplored the ruling. La resolución que tomó ahora la corte es impresionante.
The court's decision is astonishing in the impact that it is going to have. A court of the United States. So what do we have to do? Create alternatives so people do not have to take on those risks. We're concerned about that.
I'm guessing most of you probably don't agree with the mission, but that speech about Mexico having to work around new U.S. asylum restrictions did sound an awful lot like a foreign mission accomplished in Trump's eyes. Thanks, partners. Our Solicitor General did go one step further, though, in saying, additionally, the rule puts the United States in a better negotiating position by improving the United States' ability to curtail the flow of aliens across the southern border. Now, this was really the point that the administration hammered home in their arguments. By distributing the pain of resettling refugees to more countries, the United States was forcing more willingness on other countries to stop the flow of asylum seekers to their countries as well. Now, with this interpretation of spreading pain to encourage more nations to work together to end immigration flows, the Supreme Court deemed that this could have plausibly been the real incentive behind the policy. This meant that it didn't have to be discussed and agencies didn't have to be notified ahead of time. Because that's the case, the injunction that banned implementing this policy in the interim legal period was invalid. Now, none of this is actually game over for injunctions, because not only is this decision temporary, pending the battle over whether this policy is actually legal or not, but also,
the administration hypothetically can continue to implement this very controversial policy for months until a court may file another injunction. But, you know, like I said, this could take months.
So it can be blocked again, just not on the basis that it was not talked about first. So that's everything you technically need to know, but let's just, out of curiosity, see what Sonia Sotomayor had to say in her published opinion. Oh, I shouldn't have looked. Things just got a lot more confusing. Can't close the door now, though. Now, her entire opinion was based on the first district court's opinion that banned this policy countrywide. She cited 3 points. The first was a point we just heard, and the second 2 points were defeated when the government appealed the injunction to the Ninth Circuit Court that lessened its scope to just the West Coast. So first, the point that the appeals court agreed with and we just went over. There was no notice and discussion. Her second point was the real elephant in the room that most of you were probably thinking. The court found that it probably was inconsistent with an asylum statute that generally provides any non-citizen physically present in the United States or who arrives in the United States may apply for asylum. Well, that sounds like the opposite of this policy. So how did Solicitor General Francisco manage to null this claim that this policy was the exact opposite of a direct congressional desire? Well, it was a lot easier of an argument than most of you would probably hope. Simply put, the same asylum statute expressly authorizes the departments to adopt new categorical bars to asylum, and the bar adopted here is consistent with the asylum statute's other provisions. Look for a more detailed analysis of that when the actual case of whether this policy is legal or not hits the Supreme Court later this year. All I can say without being able to cite an affirmative Supreme Court decision is, well, the government agrees with at least some part of that argument. The last point she made was, well, what was the whole point of this policy? Last, the district court found the explanation for the rule so poorly reasoned that the government's action was likely arbitrary and capricious. Okay, someone had a thesaurus on hand when they were writing this. Now, this argument was also overturned at the appeals court. The basic idea here is that, on paper, the logic of this policy is flawed. It says that anybody who's truly in danger and has a real asylum claim will apply for asylum in the first country they bump into. The district court injunction looked at the government's data and found that if you apply for asylum in Mexico, you're more likely to be exposed to violence and abuse from third parties and government officials, denied their rights under Mexican and international law, and wrongly returned to the country from which they fled prosecution. Basically, the thought here was there are other reasons to apply for asylum specifically in the United States than to just survive on a bogus asylum claim here until the courts find you. Now you can tell that this judge was getting a little indignant here too, because he wrote, "Even though this mountain of evidence points one way, the agencies went the other way with no explanation." The government's rebuttal to this was essentially, "Hey, it's a good enough reason to legally achieve what we're trying to do here, so thanks for the helpful note, but we're just gonna keep going." So this is the arguments that the Supreme Court just heard. I realize that it's incredibly complicated, which makes it really hard to report on. But I hope I could shed some light on what's really happening here. Thank you, and that's definitely not all I have to say about this one. Hello YouTube, if you want to support independent journalism looking into this country's laws, economics, and foreign and domestic policies, remember to click here on this floating logo to the right of my head to subscribe. Give me a thumbs up if you like what you saw, and lastly, as always, thank you for watching.